from the 1930s to present day. As soon as my objective to go to them, I'll gather the social interaction varies throughout the century, according to changes in historical and social context and in the type of people that I'm describing. It was one of my main concerns to understand the relation between architectural functions, in this particular case, those intrinsic to the concept of dwelling, and human interactions in space, whether between individuals or groups. What function brings to the table is the ability to distinguish which individuals and groups are interacting with each other, and in what way. Indeed, if you before mentioned walls, the way you organize human activities in space was already a means to define social groups and social relatives. Inside the house, and ultimately in all human organized environments, function is what spatially organizes social roles. We can clearly see this on this slide, presenting the dwellings of primitive tribes. For example, women's place is deeply connected to the activity they are expected to carry on. To wives, to wives, should place themselves next to the kitchen, while the most important one was close to the entrance as welcome guests. As architecture evolved, these definitions became more complex and often less explicit, but social roles are still spatially defined. Even though service area functions, the kitchen, and the laundry. The areas that are not directly associated with a particular function, such as hallways, corridors, and other transition spaces, were not analyzed in themselves, but only as connectors between different areas function. After identifying areas function present in that I analyzed three types of different relations that happen between them. Relations of density, of visibility, and mobility. On the first plan are represented the densities in meters or in inhabitants of the areas of the house. It was impossible for me to find the real number of inhabitants for each case study, and so I was used to the number of bedrooms plus one, counting one of the bedrooms as housing a couple. Also, because bedrooms are used mostly by the people who sleep in them, the density values are calculated keeping this in mind, which can be seen in much larger numbers inside bedrooms than for the rest of the house. We have 15 square meters per inhabitant here because I only count one person there, and 4, 8 here because I count 7 inhabitants in the living room. Having bedrooms belong to only one or two people allows to better understand the dynamic between private and collective spaces. Of course, it is much truer in housing for middle class than for the lower classes, where it is very likely that a lot more people share the same bedroom. The second plan shows what can be seen in each area function of the rest of the house using isolates. In this case, the living areas function are visually very connected, but the rest of the apartment is only compartments, with the complex corridor system assuring the full privacy of the areas function. The mobility graph represents connection of areas function with halls and corridors in gray. The analysis of the relations of density, visibility, and mobility allow me to quantify the way each area function relates to each one and of the others and to set up all the others, and therefore to understand how likely and in what way the individuals associated with different functions were to interact with each other. I apologize that the names are in Portuguese, but they're very similar in English, so I think you can understand it. I translated these relations into four concepts of social interaction that could be understood of each area function. General integration is the first one. Where the more permeable an area function is in relation to all the others, the more it sees and is seen, and the less dense it is, the more it is generally integrated in the spatial system of which it's a part. Control, the second one. Where the more an area function can assess the others, the more it sees of others, and the deeper it is from the outside, the greater it is its control over the social interaction with the system. Privacy. Where less an area function can be seen by others, less permeable it is in relation to all spatial system, and the greater its control is, the more private it is. And segregation, where less an area function is seen by the others within the same system, the less accessible it is, the denser it is, and less control it has over the system, the more segregated it is. These are the plans of privacy, the first one, and segregation of the study apartments. The lighter spaces are, in both cases, the more private and more segregated. So we can see that we have a more private area, lighter, and less private area, and a more segregated one, the service area is so segregated that it's completely white. That is opposed to very not segregated rooms, which is not very common. The other scales were analyzed using the same logic. Here we can see that the first floor plan of the building, the apartment is located in, and the plan of the neighborhood, where I identify social, service, and commercial area functions. The development of this methodology was enabled to crystallize personal case studies, which even documents is essentially to test the method, try to be representative. This is very important, not only because you should represent other cases from the same context that I didn't have the opportunity to study, but also because they were to a certain extent studied before, so that its social functions were more or less known and were more or less a part of general architectural culture, which allowed me to confront results achieved with pre-acquired expectations. Regarding how the balance of social interaction varied throughout the century, it was possible to conclude through the analysis of case studies and from a global vision of privacy and segregation balance at different scales throughout time, that there was a progressive individualization of the family and apartment, which segregates the outside. At the same time, when in the later decades of the 20th century, both public and private promotion of housing dependent like intervention outside the apartment, the values of segregation of the outside at the scale of the building also go up. Even though the objective of the analysis of the case studies was mostly to understand general tendencies of the studied time frame, it was also possible to discover some curiosities. This seemed not to be simply formal anomalies, but as they appear in periods where architects are especially aware of their works, unconsciously ideological position to be able to, in the context of complexities and contradictions of a determined historical context, have a great power to influence at least the specific responses of their time. The first study I'm going to show located inside a time period where architects were especially politically active in discovering a new way of building housing. So, just to illustrate what this can be and better understand the used method, I'm going to talk about a couple of them. In this particular case, another neighbor of social housing from the 1950s, the architect Fernand Tavor, said that the objective to allow only the minimal private life. Indeed, the analysis of the relationships between care and pensions of the neighborhood seemed to indicate that he was successful in doing so. Very different to what was verified in studied by the time frame, housing buildings, which are named RE, are the more separated part of the complex, favoring the collective functions outside. While the closed city, named RC, so relatively low balance of privacy and segregation. Another curious example is the one presented here, which does exactly the opposite of the last case. This is especially curious because the architect of the previous case had a very big role in the movement this project is a part of. Here, in a post-revolutionary period, the architects tried to claim working class rights to live in the city center and work in close proximity with future inhabitants of the project. However, not only is location inside the city block is translated in great values of segregation from the close city, it also appears as the only case of state-funded housing where the most segregated area function is the kitchen, which is usually only verified in upper-class housing, especially when it was ordinary to have permanently. So I hope to have shown a bit of what my process was and the possibilities